Father, in the name of Jesus, as you have given me a sense of boldness to be a trumpeter tonight. And I ask that you would enable that to happen, that the boldness of the Holy Spirit, not just human boldness, that the Holy Spirit conviction, revelation, that words would enter into people's hearts, and even those that hear the tapes and the CDs out of this, even years from now in nations far away, I ask that the Spirit the Holy Spirit would strike like an arrow the heart and ignite it and let people know who they are and what they're about. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, now, I have two major concerns. I mean, really three. The obvious one is to be faithful to the Holy Spirit and to be a trumpeter. That's concern number one, to be faithful to the Holy Spirit and to be a trumpeter. It's the verse in Joel, blow the trumpet. This is the second. We have 12 evenings. This is our second one that are alarming, and some of them are disturbing. So the first thing is to be faithful to the Holy Spirit as a trumpeter. Second one is to not in any way empower an elite spirit. I hate an elite spirit where people think they're bigger, best, or first. That's always the enemy lurking in the shadows. So I want to qualify a few things, because what God's going to be doing is he's going to be raising up cities of refuge, and he has been for decades raising up apostolic companies and prophetic teams and beachheads in the spirit all over the earth. First, to be faithful to the Lord. Next thing, not to let an elite spirit in any way be cultivated or to be nurtured by hearing this testimony. And third, and certainly not least, is to be faithful and to honor the Word of God. I really care about honoring the Word of God. I'm not going to address all the pastoral issues. I've been pastoring 25 years before IHOP. Because I cannot be a trumpet blast and stop every 2.5 minutes and function in a pastoral mode. We will, in our community here, in our family, the IHOP family, we will pastor these issues thoroughly in the weeks and months and years ahead. But I'm not going to try to operate on two different levels right now. I want to be faithful to make known what the Lord's saying. I want to not in any way nurture an elite spirit. And I want to honor the Word of God, because I have 25 hours of material and I have 12 evenings to pick on half of it only. Now tonight, our second night, I would be tempted to jump into what did the Lord do in 1983 and 84 and a few angelic visitations that I'm going to get to. I think I'm going to wait another night or two. I'm going to do a little bit of that here tonight. And I'm anxious to get there, but I feel not to rush this. We must understand the global context and the hour we're living in, because what God has mandated us to do locally in Kansas City and what God has mandated in the Midwest, part of his mandate to the Midwest, certainly we don't understand it all. We have to understand the hour we're living in. The wisdom of living in Joel 2 comes out of understanding the hour we're living in. Now the question of the hour is, it's a famous question, how then shall we live? Last night and tonight, we're looking at the bigger context of which our local mandate fits in. And the question if you don't walk away with this question, then I have not been successful in the grace of God to touch you. You must go out of here saying, how then shall we live if these things be true in this hour? There's two very important passages of Scripture that have reoccurred over and over for the last 20 years. Over and over and over. It's Joel chapter 2. I was listing all of the occasions of which God has spoken Joel 2. I was amazed at the different people and the consistency of Joel chapter 2. And the next chapter would be Daniel chapter 9. And the Lord spoke both of these chapters in supernatural experience involving angelic visitations. Both of these chapters, multitudes of times in dreams to many prophetic people within our camp and outside of our little tribe here. And many, many, many times he has spoken this word and confirmed it over and over. But I want you to lock into that, because that might be new for some of you. Joel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 9 are two of the most significant chapters in terms of this history. September 1982, I've told the story many times. I've told it for 20 years. And so I'm not going to go in great detail on it, because most of you are familiar with it. I had In June 1982, he had spoken audibly. I was pastoring in St. Louis for about a seven-year period of time. And then now it's September 1982. I was doing a pastor's conference in India. So I decided I'd been on a very long extended fast through the summer of 1982, getting ready for coming to Kansas City. Oh, incidentally, I'm going to make a parenthesis. I'm not trying to make a big point of this because I know of other people that have done so much more than this. But I've been on 3 40-day fasts in my life. But I was ushered into it in a very clear way. The summer of 82, winter and spring of 97, and then this period right now. And all three of them became the thing that God set up to usher in a radical transition that changed everything. And all of them were initiated by the Lord. The Lord now in retrospect is saying, I was wiring you and I was rewiring you. I was wooing you and I was using the grace of prayer and fasting because that's going to be one of the hallmark messages out of this movement. And each one of those radical changes happened, and many of them happened suddenly because the Lord called all three of them in ways that absolutely surprised me. I didn't even have a thought of it. Like nearly just the season right before. Now, just so you get it in perspective, I know a number of people that have been on, multitudes of 40-day fasts. I mean, water fasts I'm talking about. I know one man's been on 25 of them. I know another man that's been on 20 of them. I'm not impressed by two or three of them. The unbelievers in India have been on multitudes of them. But my point is, fasting is our lifestyle. Fasting is our way in the Spirit as a movement. Fasting is part of our message. It was one of those things where just the Lord led it and boom, it happened. And here we are. Today is the 40th day, actually. Today is the actual 40th day. Here we are. I've known it all day, but I forgot it in the meeting. We are about to enter into a season of transition, and we will look back to October, November. But when we look back in 2010, I tell you, we will look at this as a radical time where our world was shifted in many, many, many ways. Many shifts are going on, many ideas, many things are taking place. So I just finished this long extended fast, and when you fast like that, you become very vulnerable to the Holy Spirit. That's one of the reasons the Lord does it. You become so vulnerable to the Holy Spirit. When you've been on a long extended fast, the yes in your spirit just becomes a capital Y-E-S. It is, and you say yes with feeling and boldness and conviction. And it's just one of God's ways to just, you put the bullseye on your chest. And so I said, Lord, here I am. I'm just really, anything goes. I'm going to Kansas City. I don't have a clue that what is waiting for me in Kansas City is a series of divine appointments, of angelic visitations. I said last night, 83 and 84 in the last 20 years are clearly the two pivotal years. That was clearly the time when the shift took place, clearly. And then in 97, when the Friends of the Bridegroom and a whole bunch of dynamics, and then IHOP came out of that, another gigantic shift is about to happen in our midst in the next year or two. So I went to the slums of major cities. I went to Cairo, Egypt. I went to see the slums. I went to Seoul, Korea. I went to see the slums and the big prayer ministry with Seoul, Korea. And I went to these places. I walked through the slums and just said, Lord, strike me. Strike me with your arrow for the poor of the earth. And the Lord gave me I call it a Holy Spirit virus I've never been cured of since. He gave me a promise about caring for the poor of the earth and about money and about ministry. And he told me that he would give me the wealth of the nations, that it would flow into my hands if I would take care of the poor of the earth, that he would continue to multiply the money beyond anything I could imagine. So here I am one night. I'm in Cairo, Egypt. I'm by myself. I'm in this hotel room. Maybe it's 8 or 9 at night. I'm just going to have an evening of prayer. I'm just so feeling the Lord's presence and loving it. Suddenly, I have one of the 3 or 4 most dramatic experiences in my whole life. But I've had 2 or 3 since then that I'm going to be telling you about in these evenings. And the Holy Spirit began to descend upon me, and the voice of the Lord spoke to me with such clarity. Talk about the internal audible voice. I heard the intonation. I heard the exact sentence. It seemed like it was external audible, but I'm just sure it wasn't. It was so clear. I heard the absolute phrase, and the Lord said, suddenly. Suddenly the Lord gave me this sentence. He goes, I am going to change the understanding and expression of Christianity in the whole earth in one generation. My being was filled with it. And the fear of the Lord as an experience. There's the spirit of the fear of the Lord we like to live in. But I've only experienced the fear of the Lord as a crisis experience one time in 30 years. It was that night. Maybe it was an hour, maybe it was an hour and a half. I was kneeling there and the terror of God in my being shook as I'm encountering the Lord. And he has spoken this sentence to me. And when he says it, I hear the words very clearly. And then I get the clear Holy Spirit discernment after this. The impressions are unmistakable. And now I'm in the impression level here, but they're very clear, unmistakable. When he says, I will change the understanding and the expression of Christianity on the earth in one generation. When he said, I will change the understanding. I knew instantly by the Spirit the way the unbeliever understands Christianity. Right now, the unbelievers around the earth, Christianity is not just boring, not as only non-threatening. Christianity is irrelevant to most unbelieving communities. Few exceptions. In Acts chapter 4, when they associated with the early church, they trembled. It doesn't mean they didn't associate, because many were getting saved, so unbelievers had to associate with the early church. Carefully, soberly, they were fearful to associate with the early church. That wholesome spirit of sobriety and caution is going to return. The way we're understood, we're going to be understood radically different within one generation. And of course, back then, I would have assumed that generation would have started right then. The Lord didn't say it. He just said within one generation. And I've been asked for years, when did the generation start? And I always have to say, I don't know. But I always add, but I hope now. I hope it starts now. And I say the same thing. I don't know when it starts, but I hope it started now. And so, things are going to change radically. The unbelievers are going to understand us so entirely different. Well, we are bored with the church. How much more unbelievers? But it's all going to change. He said, I'm going to change the understanding of Christianity in one generation, the way it's perceived by unbelievers, by kings and presidents and leaders of nations. Number two, he said, I'm going to understand the expression of Christianity, the expression of it. And I knew instantly when it said the expression of Christianity, the understanding, I just perceived it by the Holy Spirit. It was a Holy Spirit discernment. It wasn't just my logical thinking. I knew it was from God. He made it clear the way you live your life together will be radically different. And so for 20 years, I've looked around the over the horizon across the other countries. What's new? What's new? And now here we are at the 3-year anniversary just recently of IHOP. And I understand more and more. I don't mean I have all the details. He says, I'm going to make my house a house of prayer for all nations. The local church across the earth will function under the anointing of a house of prayer. Isaiah 56:7, it struck me so clearly. He goes, by the way, what we're doing at IHOP is so immature. IHOP's a bit boring sometimes. We're learning. It's not that anointed. There are some anointed times. I don't mean what we're doing is it. We're still on the outer edges of it, but at least I can see the light now at the end of the tunnel. And I just say, Lord, you mean multiply this times 10 in the anointing, multiply this times 1,000 in the gatherings. The stadium Christianity is around the corner. And whether that's 1 year, 10 years, or 50 years, I don't know, but it's around the corner. The church structures right now are like scaffolding for something new that's going to happen. And when this new thing happens, God is going to call the meetings. They will gather in the stadiums, and they will come in. All the believers will come in. Maybe 100,000 will come in. Maybe 100,000 new converts will be released in that 10, 20, 30-day period. Now the Lord says, now go back out for the next 6 or 12 or 18 months, and it will be all different. Current structures today will be challenged, stretched. But let me tell you this. Don't think that all denominations are wrong. God's going to anoint some key leaders and denominations. And there will be whole tribes that will accept the renewal. I don't mean renewal as we thought about it in the 90s. I'm talking about renewal, capital R, at a whole nother level. There will be entire systems and tribes and organizations that will come in, and the top 5 or 10 men or women will be so radically impacted, they will lay everything down. They will throw it all down before the Lord, and there'll be all kinds of reorganization by the Holy Spirit, and some entire denominations will be renewed in power And so don't look at denominations and say, well, they're all finished. You wait and see. There's going to be some noble men and women at the center of them, and they're going to lead them into abandonment, and entire tribes will be reordered in short amount of periods. But what's going to happen is something like this. It's going to be a Tuesday afternoon. This is a made-up scenario. There's going to be a couple of people standing in a parking lot. It's maybe one of the colleges, and some little 18-year-old gal is going to lay hands on her friend, and all of a sudden a tumor is going to fall off right in front of everybody, and a blind eye is going to open, and she's going to take a step back and says, I've never seen anything like this. And all of a sudden there's going to be a stir. All of a sudden 10 or 20, 30 people gather, and they say, I want to bring my family members over. Will you do it again? She goes, I've never done this. They go to an apartment that night. All of a sudden there's 500 people cramming in a little apartment. That's Tuesday. By Wednesday noon, there'll be 12, 15, 20,000. By Wednesday night, there'll be 70,000. By Thursday night, there'll be 100,000 on the inside and 50,000 on the outside trying to get in. That's how the meeting will be called. And they'll be there on Thursday night with 50,000 on the outside trying to get in and thinking, man, this thing began in that little library parking lot on Tuesday afternoon by that little 18-year-old girl. So I'm in Cairo, Egypt. He says, I'm going to do this in one generation. The fear of God is all over me. My whole being is trembling. My being is trembling. And when the Lord says, I will change, and I understood the emphasis of I, it will be sovereignly initiated. The King of Kings is orchestrating it. He goes, I will change. And when the Lord says, I'm going to change the synagogue system to an early church with fishermen, I'm telling you, when the power bases shift, if it happens in political arenas, they call it revolution. It's called a revolution. If it happens in the spiritual arena, conflict. Here's my point of telling you this. You're saying yes, most of you in this room, the vast majority, you're saying yes. I've cared enough about that word change to study political and spiritual changes through history. And I'm telling you, they are bloody, they are hurtful. It is not a pretty sight to the flesh. But the Lord says, I am changing. And the word changing is the scary part. And it's going to happen across the whole earth. It's not going to be just in America or just in England or just in one nation. It's going to be a global reality. And it's going to be a quick work. It's going to be a suddenly of God. It's going to happen in one generation. It's going to happen suddenly. And within a generation, the Lord didn't tell me what a generation was. 40 years, 50 years, 70 years. I don't know. He just said within one generation, it will be a suddenly of God that will hit the earth. So Cairo, Egypt, I'm on the floor and I'm weeping and I'm trembling. I mean, I'm weeping in this little hotel and I'm trembling and I'm saying, yes, yes. And the Lord spoke to me yet another time. He says, you have only said yes, but you have not yet done it. And that was surprising. That came with the same clarity as the other sentence. I will change the understanding and expression of Christianity to the earth in one generation. He said, you've only said yes, but you've not yet done it. And I was crying, yes, yes. I was getting louder, yes, yes. And he says another sentence. He says, others have said yes, but did not do it. Others have said yes, but did not do it. I'm going, yes, and I'm trembling. And when the Lord speaks a word, it resounds through your being. It's like it resounds through you. And it might even take 5 or 10 minutes. And you're quaking under it. It seems like it's the same sentence when he said others have said yes, but not have done it. It's 10 minutes later, possibly. And it seems like it's 1 second after the sentence is over because it's still resounding through the corridors of your being. That's how it is when the Lord speaks to you at that kind of level. And then he gave me one more word. He said this. He goes, guard your heart lest your brethren steal these things from your heart. And that was a troubling word. And I, you know, all these years I go, my brethren, who are my brethren? You know, is it my natural? Is it the ones I'm working with? Is it the guys in the city? Is it the guys in the nation? Is it the guys in the earth? Who are these guys? And I don't know. And it's interesting, the very first day that Bob Jones met me, the very first day on March 7th, 83, that he gave me that word. He said, the Lord told me he's given you a commission that your little young mind, I was 27. He says, you can't comprehend. You cannot comprehend what I'm telling you right now. But the Lord told me this. He said that though there are those around you that are too strong for you. He said, they're like rabid dogs. Their throats are swollen up and you're in the river. They're on the banks. They cannot flow in the spirit. They sit on the banks, they analyze the river, they criticize the river, but he said they're like, their throats are swollen like rabid dogs, they never drink in the river.
The unbelievers are going to take us serious, and there's going to be a weighty sobriety. The believers are going to dwell together as a house of prayer. And I mean, I'm not talking about do what we do at IHOP. I'm talking about living in an unction of divine authority, whether it's worship and miracles break forth, presence worship, Paul Kane talked about, whether they talk to one another and they're right in the flow of prophesying while they're talking and breaking the bonds of wickedness off of the one they're talking to. It's prayer at every level, and it's 24/7, and it's a whole different paradigm than checking into the weekly meeting and then going to do your life. Even if it's a revival church, God's going to do something global, far beyond Kansas City. This is a global phenomenon in the Holy Spirit. But he's asking for Joel chapter 2 lifestyles to be forerunners, to be breaker anointings that break this open in parts of the earth. He is going to use humans to break it open. There's many places in America. He's giving them the invitation to have a breaker anointing to break the thing open into another season, into a new realm, a new hour. And there's a breaker anointing upon this ministry if we want it. A little bit of it's functioning, but God's going to raise up breaker anointings. And these people need to press in. They need to press in. And God's going to use the body of Christ to break it open. Micah chapter 2 verse 13 is talking about the Lord, actually. It says there, but it's a type of the forerunner, the one who breaks out in order to break open. There it is, Micah chapter 2, verse 13. God's raising up men and women that break out of the old paradigms. They break out of the old way. They break out of the mindsets. And they break out in their personal life in order to break open for multitudes to go into that new breaking and that opening. And we are one of many, many places the Lord is saying, I will give you. I have invited you to a breaker anointing for this word I gave you in Cairo, Egypt. Other prophetic people have different sentences. They don't use the same sentences God gave me in Egypt, but it's the same reality, and I hear it all the time. I love to hear the prophets of God across the earth, men and women, old and young, different language, different colors, different fragrances, same idea. And I hear it, it sounds all different languages. I go, that's the same word I received. It's just a different on-ramp to the same river. Okay, so the bigger context, things are going to be real different. Just a little bit of review from last night because I covered so much. I want to give some bullet points to kind of bring us to a place of clarity so that our context, we have a context for understanding the more local mandate that we're going to get into maybe tomorrow night. Paul Kane, the June 88 experience in the Lord that he had when he saw three different nations, three different time frames. The first 3 months was America, and it happened, and that was a faith builder. It took place, exactly like he said. I mean, it's parabolic, but it happened unmistakably. And then he gave something a little bit bigger, Soviet Union, and a little bit longer time frame, 18 months, and the fall of communism, and it came down. But that wasn't the full message. That was just the faith builder, the third message, that there was going to be a coming together of the spirit of communism, the demons that energize communism and the demons that energize Islam are coming together in an unholy union, and it's going to create a worldwide empire. I mean, an empire that touches the whole world. It won't conquer the whole world, but it will touch the whole world. It will affect the whole world. It will be based in Europe, in Russia. Mostly in Europe, but Europe and Russia. Here's what the Lord told Paul Kane. It will be horrendously evil that will strike terror. It will be horrendously evil. It is the man of sin himself leading this empire. And it says, however, God is going to have a people who will raise up in victory in the authority of Christ Jesus. And they will stand. Though many will be martyred, they will stand victorious. Revelation 15, they're around the throne. It says they sang the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. They came off victorious. They died as martyrs, but they were victorious in love. And many will be victorious on the earth in love, and their bodies will be protected. And we don't know which one is which. We don't know which one is which, but we know this. The people of God will operate in divine authority. The words of Paul Kane, Joel's army, the Joel 2 lifestyle, the stadium Christianity. First, as we gather, they're going to be massive, solemn assemblies. We're gathering because the miracles are breaking. Come together for a day of fasting and prayer for the city. And we plan it for one day, and it's 30 days later, and we're still meeting. So, and suddenly the presence of God breaks in, and the meeting just goes on and on and on. And the guys that run the stadium are the ones whose daughter got healed. So they said, hey, you can use this Stadium, no problem. Massive solemn assemblies that are seized by God and turned into 30-day gatherings. Okay, I talked a little bit about Bob Jones. Now, I'm going to tell you a bit about Bob Jones. Most of you don't know him. You've never met him. Though I've seen, Bob Jones, Paul Kane are just the two I'm talking about right now. There's many more prophetic vessels. They're certainly not infallible men, and they don't want to be looked at that way, and nobody looks at them that way. So I just want to say that real clear. But I had a dream one night, and Bob Jones called me up the next day and had the dream I had. And he said, "You had a dream last night, didn't you?" And he told me what it was. That probably happened 5 or 10 times. Never once did he miss it. Never once did he call me and say, "You had one," and I said, "No." Or he said, "You had one," and I said, "What was it?" And he did not have exactly the message of that dream. That was staggering the first time that happened. I went, "Wait a second." I said, "I didn't tell anybody. It's 8:00 in the morning. I haven't told anybody. I just had the dream. What is this?" And you never get used to that. Never. You just never get used to that. And that happened 5 or 10 times. 5 or 10 times again. I there's an actual number if I just thought it through. I remember I was with these two pastors once. I'm telling them about Bob Jones. Now these two pastors ran into me 10 minutes before. I didn't even know I was going to see them or anything. And I'm telling them about Bob Jones. And they said, "Can we meet him?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "You know, he might know I'm talking to you right now." And they said, "What?" I said, "Well, let's just try it. You know. And I said, "Did I know I was going to see you?" They go, "No." I said, "Okay, so there's no way I knew that I was going to see you. You guys ran into me, right?" "Right." "Okay, good." I said, "Let me call Bob Jones. Let me dial the phone and let me say nothing." Okay, I've called the phone. I said, "Hello, Bob?" "Yes." "Yes." "Okay, bye." And I hung up. They said, "What? What?" And I said, I called him. I go, "Hello, Bob." Bob says, "Two of them?" I go, "Yes." He goes, "Presbyterian pastors?" I go, "Yes." He goes, "Bring them on over." It's exactly what happened. And I had these two guys. I said, "Yes, yes," and hung up. They said, "Like, what? What?" I said, "Let's go." I said, "I won't say a word. I'll walk in. He'll tell you what he told me." He walked in. He said, "I knew it was two of you. You guys are Presbyterians, aren't you?" And they went like this. They go, I go, "Did I stop and make a phone call between here and there?" I go, "No, of course not." That happened at least 5 or 10 times. Elijah, I think it was Elisha who said it, when Gehazi was out doing some mischief, and he came back and he said, "Did not my heart go with you?" And there's Paul Kane. That's happened, literally more times with Paul Kane. It's unnerving, but it's powerful. It's powerful. It's powerful. That's happened 5 or 10 times with Bob Jones, where I had a dream 5 or 10 times where I was with an appointment with somebody, and it was a divine appointment, and it happened. I have seen Paul Kane call out in my presence at least 1,000 people where he told them their name or told them intimate information, where they lived, what the name of their children was in a foreign city. He went to the meeting. I can picture many times, lady in the blue, you stand up. She stands up. "Do I know you?" "No." "You were born September 18th. I have seen that so many times. I don't mean 100. I'm talking about 1,000 times I have witnessed this in foreign cities across the earth where he knew nobody and I knew nobody. I got on the plane with him and we went there together. My point being, we're talking about a prophetic anointing. This is nothing compared to where this thing is going. We won't even tell these kind of stories because they will be lower in their impact in the days to come. You guys, many of you will be operating in a prophetic anointing and your children, your sons and daughters that you can't imagine right now. I remember one time Bob Jones came up to me. I'm just giving you a feel for it because I feel like I'm talking so much about them. And some of you say, I can't get a feel for these guys. You know, I know they're both 75 or they will be in a few years. But I know that about them. But I can't get a sense for it. I remember one time Bob Jones in front of the whole congregation stood up and said, this is in August 1987. He goes, on October 19th, judgment's coming to America. I said, October 19th, what's that? He goes, I don't know. It might be military. It could be economic. I don't know why the Lord will give it to me. But he just said, October 19th, he's shaking America. October 19th, the stock market fell 500 points on that day. And they called it the worst day since 1929. He says, February 17th is going to be a day for the church. February 17th, Jimmy Swaggart confesses his sin on February 17th. That's the kind of accuracy that Bob and Paul have had. Things I'm pointing out last night and a little bit tonight are things of a global dimension that create a context. So here's what the angel visits Bob on August 7th, 1975. And the angel tells him, World War III is coming. World War III is coming. And I want to tell you, it is coming. Again, 25 is not an actual number, but it's many, some number like that. I have prophetic friends all around the world. They've all seen it. I mean, in multiplied prophetic dreams and visions, multiplied. They've seen this thing happen. World War III is coming. World War III is coming. And I want to tell you, Revelation chapter 6, we looked at it last night, verse 4 and verse 8. World War III is coming, and 1/4 of the population of the earth is going to die. World War II was the most horrific hour of human history in terms of deaths. You know how many died? 50 million in 6 years. Unthinkable. 10 million died in World War I, plus 50 million die in World War II. 50 million people in 6 years. Unthinkable. Do you know what 1/4 of the world's population, let's say it's 20 years from now. I mean, I don't know the timing. They say in the year 2025, the world population will be 10 billion. Do you know if that happens in 20 years, out of 10 billion people, that's 2.5 billion people. Do you know how much more that is than World War II? 50 times the size of World War II and the amount of people who die. 50 times World War II is 2.5 billion people. 1/4 of if there are 10 billion. My point isn't to get the numbers right, but I think that's probably in the ballpark, but that's just simple math. The natural information tells you there'll be 10 billion in 20 years. Beloved, do you understand what God is in his mercy wanting to get the church ready for? So the angel tells him World War III is coming. He tells him there's going to be cities of refuge raised up across the earth. And he tells him specifically, Kansas City is one of the cities of refuge. Now, I don't know what the other ones are. I believe there'll be cities of refuge on the East Coast and West Coast and all through the Middle East and Europe and everywhere. I just don't know what they are. I've heard a number of testimonies about in the East Coast, Charlotte and Atlanta. I've had a half a dozen prophetic people tell me that about both of those two cities. I don't know. I'm not sure, but it sounds believable to me. But in these cities of refuge, let me tell you what's going to happen. Here's what the Lord has shown. It's clear in the scripture. It happened with Moses in the wilderness, a moving city of refuge. If you want to get a picture of it, read the book of Exodus. Supernatural provision, agriculture, when there's... Because the angel told Bob this. He said they're going to raise up cities of refuge because there will be famine all around the earth. But just read Revelation chapter 6, verse 6. There's famine all over the earth. It's clear. Well, it's already all over the earth right now, but it's going to multiply as World War III breaks out. There's going to be supernatural provision and economics. The angel told Bob, economics beyond anything you can think of, it'll be supernatural. And the agriculture, the animals, there'll be rain in 1 and 200 mile areas. There'll be cities of refuge. There'll be pockets of mercy in the midst of nations where the agriculture and the herds and the economics will multiply like Joseph. It'll be supernatural provision, but it's more than that. There'll be supernatural protection. Psalm 91 will be employed. I don't mean that nobody will die. I don't mean nobody will be martyred. But there'll be multiplied stories of Psalm 91 protecting their outer man, not just their inner man. And there's going to be Holy Spirit direction. There'll be open heavens over those geographic areas. And what I mean by open heavens, I don't mean every day is an angel, but an abundance of flowing revelation giving direction. The angel told Bob that Kansas City was one of these cities of refuge. And the angel said, look! And Bob looked over there. He was in this, I told you, it was a death experience. And he looks over there and he sees this bright light, like radiant brightness coming out of Kansas City. And it goes all over a 500-mile radius. And the Lord said that light, I don't mean it will all come from Kansas City, but Kansas City will impact the 500-mile radius in a very, very dynamic way. And the 500-mile radius will impact itself in a very dynamic way. But he said the whole Midwest would be an area where God would do something for the earth. He would provide for the earth, not entirely, but it would be a place of provision. It would be a pocket of mercy. I don't mean the whole thing, but many places that would act as prophetic and intercession for the nations of the earth. The angel told him the stadiums would be filled. Arrowhead Stadium would be filled. And it would be prophetic singers that it would lead the way. And many, many great things would happen. Limited nuclear exchange. I mentioned that, and I'm going to get this for you. I'm just going to have to spend some time to get it together. But we're going to get you George Washington's vision, where he saw the fire touching the cities, different cities on the East Coast. Now, on the West Coast, again, this is the testimony of a number of prophets. And this doesn't, some of this you don't even have to prophesy. It's kind of obvious. But the Spirit of the Lord has said it anyway, even though it is obvious, that there's going to be an increase of earthquakes, a significant increase of earthquakes and diseases, particularly related to immorality. But strands of diseases and mutations on them. Now, that's going to be a time for people to move there and build churches that flow as houses of prayer. It's not a time to escape. It's a time to move there. The Lord told Bob that there would be many moving because of fear. Some will move by Holy Spirit revelation, and some will go back to the two coasts by Holy Spirit revelation. You do what God tells you, but the Lord showed him the trend of many people who aren't listening to the Lord will move to the Midwest out of fear. Again, many will move out of the Holy Spirit, leading them to the Midwest for prophetic and apostolic strategic reasons ahead of time. But even many people from the Midwest will move to the coast to go build the house of prayer. And I don't mean IHOPs. I'm talking about New Testament churches operating with fasting and prayer and the prophetic anointing and intercession, etc. Okay. The Lord told Bob that over the Kansas City, but over the whole Midwest, he was raising up this banner called prophetic and intercession. And then through the years, not just in one experience, the Lord has made it clear to Bob as well as to others that God has called the Midwest, our redemptive gifting. Our redemptive gifting in the Midwest is prophetic and intercession. Look at history. The pioneers in the early days would come to the Midwest cities, Kansas City, Chicago, other places, to get supplies to go conquer the new area. It was a place of supply. It was a place where provision was released. Two very powerful situations in history, dramatic, two of the worst situations in history is World War II. And the other worst I'm talking about in terms of pain and trauma is the dispersion of the nation of Israel for 2,000 years. And there was a man from Kansas City, no man's responsible, but his vote was the biggest vote of anybody in the earth on the two of the most significant, minus obviously death and resurrection and the ministry of Jesus and the church. I mean, we're talking about outside of that, what two more incredibly dramatic events than World War II and the return of the nation of Israel after 2,000 years. One man acting as an intercessor, not even knowing it, and the Lord tells Bob Jones, he's a first fruits, he's a down payment, he's in this political arena, what I will raise up for the earth in the spirit arena all through the Midwest, prophetic and intercession. I met Bob Jones. He said, you're going to be right next to Harry S. Truman. He was a first fruit, he was a down payment. And I said, I don't even know what you're talking about, and here we are. You know, these many years later, and the building we've been in all these years is 100-300 yards away from Harry S. Truman's house. And Bob says, you'll be there, I guarantee it. It's just God's prophetic poetry, because this is about intercession and prophetic, and that man was a first fruit. Now, interesting, one of our guys years ago was digging through the attic of his father and grandfather, and he found a book that was written in 1922, 1925, I don't know. It said, History of Kansas City, secular, natural history. You know what the fathers of the city named Kansas City? It's a secular history book. History. He opens it up. It says, Kansas City. Here's the name of it in the natural. The prophetic city at the mouth of the Kaw River. He showed it to me. He goes, look at this. He goes, this is by secular people 50 years ago wrote this. But that was what the city fathers, unbelieving city fathers, named the city. And they were doing it because it was launching the pioneer movements out west and supply. And they have no idea that in the spirit over this city, over the Midwest, God says prophetic and intercession. And God will keep all of the Holy Spirit covenants that he made with our forefathers. And well, here's my point. And America will be occupied. It will not be conquered. There will be resistant forces. There will be redneck resistors. There will be patriot resistors. Some of them will be apostolic companies in cities of refuge in an open heaven moving in signs and wonders with the administration from heaven. There will be many types of resistance. It'll go maybe 2-3 years on the short end, 4-5 years on the long end. The Lord himself will end it. He will keep his covenant that he made with the fathers, and he will cause many great things to come after that. Amen.